Good morning, everybody. How are you today? And I wanted to share a real quick scripture with you from Philippians. I'm going to start at verse 20. It says, I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. And this is the key point I wanted to share. For me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And I thought about that as we put this song, Just a Closer Walk with Thee, together, because it's a song that talks about where we should be always striving to live our lives, to let our bodies, ourselves, exemplify Christ, especially when we're out in the community and people see us, because they're looking to us for Christian leadership. That we're the only place they're going to get it. They're not going to get it from unsaved people, and that's where we have to be in our hearts and in our spirit. And of course, when time comes to go home, it gets better. It's a gain for us. So good morning. We're here to praise the Lord. Let's go ahead and get this started. Praising the Lord by doing this poorly. So we're going to start over so that I can praise the Lord better and know what I'm supposed to be doing. I apologize to you. I figure it's better instead of trying to rescue halfway through, I just get more and more nervous and upset and mess it up more. So I want to glorify the Lord this morning. And I hear your voices. Let's go ahead and lift them up.
Please have a seat and welcome to Cornerstone Church, where our mission is to be a loving family of faith who joyfully responds to God's grace and the power of the Holy Spirit. And we pray that you feel welcomed. We pray that the Holy Spirit is welcome today as we seek to worship God in spirit and truth. So a few announcements to share. Tonight is our last Bible study on the Gospel of John. We're going to tackle chapter 21. So if you guys can, you all can join us through Zoom at 7 o'clock. That would be terrific. I'll send out the invitation. And if you... if you're not on my email list, but you'd like to be part of the Bible study, please send me a text or email or someone that's in the group, and we'll get you connected to that. So tonight will be obviously the end of the Gospel of John, and then next week is what? Memorial Day? Is that Memorial Day weekend?
Labor Day.
Labor Day? I always get those confused. So Labor Day weekend. And so what my plan is, next Sunday, I'm going to send out the first lesson for the Bible scavenger hunt. And that's going to be on Genesis chapter 1, creation, okay? And so I'll send that out a week from tonight. We will not have a Bible study week from tonight since it's Labor Day weekend. And then the following Sunday, then, we'll discuss those questions from the sheet I send out next week. So basically, we're taking a break next week. But we'd love for you all to be involved with the Bible scavenger hunt. I think it's going to be fun. It'll be a way for us to get kind of, over time, get a holistic understanding of Scripture. And it'll be really good. So hope you participate. This Wednesday, we're having our men's Bible study, and we've finished Exodus now. I actually think I put Exodus on the thing, but we're actually going to look at Leviticus chapter 16. And Leviticus might sound kind of scary. A lot of the chapters are pretty boring, to be honest with you. But chapter 16 is very interesting. It talks about the scapegoat, and then we'll look at that this coming Wednesday. And then the next week, we'll look at chapter 25, which is the year of Jubilee, which is talking about social justice and helping the poor and that kind of thing. So it'll be hopefully very helpful in understanding God's word. Coming this Tuesday, the PYM Square group is going to have a fun time at the Maplewood Pool. We're going to have a little fellowship pool party. So I'll be from 6 to 8, so hope all the youth can make it. And that'll be really nice. And then coming up after that is the Beautiful Noise concert that Vicki and Taylor are putting on. It's on September 18th from 7 o'clock, I believe, is when we're having it. So that'll be really, really great. Bring your own chair and just enjoy some beautiful music that praises the Lord. So the last thing is the ladies are going to start a Bible study on October 14th. It's called Trustworthy, and it's based on 1 and 2 Kings. And Barbara Chenier is organizing that. So if you'd like to have a book, ladies, please let Barbara know and let her know by the end, before the end of September, so she can order those in time for the study. So we've got lots of good things coming up. I'm excited. And hope you all will participate in those events. But right now, Pastor DJ is going to lead us in the opening psalm and prayer as we continue to worship our Lord.
Good morning, church. Good to see your beautiful faces. Well, most of them in those masks. And to those that are online, it's so good to have you with us this morning. I have the pleasure of bringing our call to worship, which will be Psalms chapter 103, verses 8 through 22. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. For he knows how we were made. He remembers that we are dust. As for mortals, their days are like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field, for the wind passes over it, and it is gone. And its place knows it no more. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. The Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, O you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, obedient to his spoken word. Bless the Lord, all his hosts, his ministers that do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works, in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Amen and amen. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, bless you, O my soul. Lord, good morning. We thank you for the opportunity to be before you. And Lord God, we die to self so that we may hear you, so that we may receive you, so that we may move out of the way and experience you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day that you have made. We are rejoicing and we are glad in it. Lord, thank you for renewal and rejuvenation. Lord God, thank you for restoration, dear Lord. And thank you, dear Lord, for creating in us a new spirit and a new heart. Create in us a new heart. Heavenly Father, bless our pastor today as he brings our word. Bless our worship today as we come before you with sincere hearts. Heavenly Father, bless our congregation, whether it be here in the building or out in the world or out through virtual. Bless them indeed. We love you, Lord, and we believe what we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand and join us if you would.
How great is our God.
Susan Horan came up to me just right before the worship service started and shared that it's her mother's 95th birthday today. So, so that's a huge milestone. Pretty amazing how God has sustained her through the years. And so we're certainly going to include Angelina in our prayers today. She does have Alzheimer's or dementia and has been struggling with that for some time, but she knows that God loves her, and she feels God's love through Susan and other family members who take care of her from both from afar and close to home. So we'll include Angelina in our prayers today. But having said that, please bow your heads and join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. And Lord God, so often our hearts are filled with fear as we look inwardly at our own selves, our own sinfulness and our brokenness and our shame, and we wonder how you could ever love someone like us. And we thank you, God, that your love is so great, that you drive out our fears, that you fill us with your peace, that you give us hope, not only for today and for tomorrow, but for eternity. And for that, we are so grateful. We pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would be at work in our hearts so that you would deepen our faith and deepen our trust in you, and help us to be more sincere and more faithful in seeking to keep your commands, to love you with all of our heart and to love our neighbor as ourself. We thank you, Lord God, that we can gather as your people, both physically present in this building as well as through social media and other outlets, to worship you today and to share one another's burdens and to celebrate each other's joys. And Lord God, we do celebrate today Angelina's 95th birthday, and we thank you for the amazing long life that you have given her, and we thank you through faith in Christ that she has a certain hope of eternal life. And we pray that you just draw her near to you, Lord, and that she would be filled with peace knowing that you're watching over her and you love her. Lord God, we pray also for Caitlin's father, Linwood, who's battling cancer right now. He's enduring chemotherapy and dealing with infection. And we pray, Lord God, that you would be at work in him to bring him healing and to make him well. And we pray through the midst of this, Lord, that he would remember your love and know that you're present with him in his time of need. God, we pray for Susan's niece's husband, Matt, who does in fact have cancer of the esophagus and it's metastasized and he's now going to be in hospice care. We continue, Lord, in faith and trust to ask you to do a miraculous work and to bring him physical healing. But Lord God, we also just ask that you are with him and with his family, and that in your infinite wisdom and love and power, as one who loves them, as a father loves his children, as a perfect father loves his children, Lord God, we pray that you bless Stacy and her children with your peace and strength and hope, and just be everything they need you to be, Lord God, and be their comfort and their strength and their shield. Lord, we pray for Gary Woodyard, who's had vision problems recently, and we pray, God, that you'd bring healing to him from that as well. And he and his family have been through so much these past few years, and we thank you for their faith and their trust in you, and just ask that you continue to be with them in their time of need, and you'd be glorified through Gary and through the life of Sue and their children. We lift up to you Kevin as he's continued to heal from the car accident, and we pray that you would strengthen him and mend his bones and ligaments together, that you'd heal the damage to his eyes. And Lord God, we ask that you comfort his heart and you bring healing to his soul as he longs for his brother and grieves Victor's passing. We pray that you fill him with a peace that surpasses all understanding. We ask, Lord God, that you bless Bella and Billy and Angel and Dylan and other family members and others who love Victor so much with comfort and strength. We pray for Gabrielle, Lord God, and continue to ask that you watch over her and bless and keep her and help her, God, just to be a light of faithfulness and of love and trust that shines in her family and shines for all who see her, that she would continue to be a source of encouragement, and that her family members and loved ones will continue to encourage her and to go with her in this difficult journey. Draw her near to you, Lord God, and help her never to lose sight of the promise of the resurrection, the gift of eternal life through faith in Jesus. Lord God, we thank you for the four-day movement. We thank you so much for this ministry that Pastor DJ and Ruthie and others are so deeply involved with. We thank you for their seeking to be the hands and feet of Christ and ministering to the least of these. And there's so much need in the world right now, especially, God, with COVID and unemployment rates going up and people losing their homes. Help them, God. Give them energy and strength and determination to continue to serve you well and to build your kingdom. Lord God, we pray for Kwetu Faraja and Lori's ministry in Tanzania. We're so thankful that she's graduated from the nursing program and now is able to serve as a nurse in Indiana, fulfilling her scholarship requirements. And we ask, Lord God, that you bless her family, that she and Paul continue to serve you well, and they're able to administer leadership to Kwetu Faraja from a distance, even as they are anxious to go back and to love on these boys and to help them to grow up to become men of God. Help us to come alongside them and encourage them and to be a blessing to them in sharing this ministry. Lord, we pray for our nation. There's a lot of turmoil and brokenness and conflict right now, and we pray that a spirit of peace would pass over our country and you'd help us to learn the lessons of civility. Help us, Lord God, as disciples of Christ, to love our neighbor as ourself. Help us to bear witness to the world of your goodness and your peace, your kindness and mercy. And help us, Lord God, to be an instrument that you use for your glory as we seek to build your kingdom on earth and make an impact in the world. Lord, we pray that you would end the spread of this virus and just help us to be at peace, knowing that you're in control, that you're sovereign, that you watch over us, and we have nothing to fear. Help us, Lord God, to trust you in this strange and difficult time and to know that you'll bring us through it. Lord, I thank you for the honor it is to share your word today, and I pray that it'll be well received. I pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would lead me to share the things that you'd have me to share, and that you'd lead us to receive the things that you'd have us to receive, that you'd help us to know you in a deeper way and to follow you in with greater trust, that your love would drive out any fear that's in our hearts, and that you might be glorified in us as we seek to live more as your people. And now, Lord God, I'd like for us to offer the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, today we're continuing our sermon series on the good doctor and the great physician. And the text today is going to be from 1 John chapter 4, verses 16 through 21. And so I want to ask you now to listen attentively to God's word. This is 1 John chapter 4, verses 16 through 21. And John says, God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us, and those who say, I love God, and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So I think this is our sixth message on the sermon series, The Good Doctor and the Great Physician. And this message is going to be based off of the episode number 16, and it's called Pain. But the theme really I'm working on here is more about fear and the reasons that we have the reason we have for not being afraid. And, you know, normally I focus, or up to now I've focused on just one storyline within each episode and kind of use that as a basis of which to create the message. Well, today I'm actually going to kind of try to mesh together two storylines from the same episode, because there are two couples in the story, and in each case, one of the members of one of the couples needs to have surgery, is considering having a surgery, and the need for the surgery in each case kind of causes fear within the relationship among the couples to kind of come to the surface, and then they figure out how they're going to deal with that fear. So In the first storyline, there's a middle-aged woman named Emma. And Emma comes into the hospital, and she has kind of some red coloring on her right cheekbone. And she shares that she's had cosmetic surgery. She had an implant in her cheekbone, and that implant has become infected. And she doesn't seem particularly concerned about it. She feels like she can probably just get some antibiotics. Doctor gives write her a prescription, and she can go home. But as they do kind of an evaluation of her, they come to learn that she's had all kinds of cosmetic surgery. She had implants in her cheekbone. She's had a butt lift and a tummy tuck and liposuction and breast augmentation. And she's got all these things. And all of these implants are a potential reservoir for infection. And so this is a dangerous situation to be in. And so initially, Dr. Andrews kind of says, well, maybe just some antibiotics will work. And as it turns out, they have to actually physically, surgically remove the implant from her cheekbone and then continue to monitor and see how things go. But then the infection does spread. She's got it in her lower back now. And Dr. Andrews comes to her and says, you know, we need to remove all the implants. All these implants that you have, we need to remove all of them because this infection is dangerous. And he's very frank with her, and he tells her that he's going to have to cut away some of the healthy underlying tissue, and it's going to cause, he says, unfortunately, it's going to cause significant and permanent scarring. And she's like, you can't do that. She says, I'm going to look worse than I did before. And she's really alarmed, and Dr. Andrews kind of thinks for a minute, and he says, I suppose we could try some strong, broad-spectrum antibiotics and see if that works. And he says, I really don't want to do that. He says, you could become septic. He says, you could die. And Emma looks at her husband, Barry, and he kind of looks at her, and he doesn't say anything. He just looks at her, and then she turns to the doctor, and she says, it'll work. It has to. Well, unfortunately, the antibiotics don't work. And so Dr. Andrews comes back to her, and he tells her that he needs to remove these implants immediately, that she could die from this infection, that she will die from this infection. And inconceivably, she says, no. She says, I'm not going to do it. And all this cosmetic surgery that she's had has been driven by this fear. She thinks that in order for her to be lovable, she has to be beautiful in the eyes of her husband. And so she refuses to have these implants removed, and it's completely irrational. But it's like she'd rather die than be rejected by her husband. Later in the show, we come to understand that Barry, her husband, has his own fears. And he's ashamed of something and he fears that his wife will lose respect for him if it's found out. And so there's this irony happening here. The irony is that their fear of rejection is the very thing that's driving them apart. Now, the other storyline is also intriguing. Hunter is a man who was paralyzed in a motorcycle accident. He's paralyzed from the chest down. He's been paralyzed for 10 years, and over time he's learned to adapt and kind of accept the fact that he's paralyzed. And somewhere along the line, after he was paralyzed, he married a woman named Cora. And Cora is a fantastic lady. She's really kind and generous, and they have a great marriage, and she's glad to help Hunter when he needs it due to the limitations of his paralysis, and they just get along great, and it's really nice. Well, he comes to the hospital because he's got some pain in his neck, and they start kind of feeling around, seeing what's going on, and they squeeze the back of his neck, and shockingly, he has this surge of pain that rushes through his legs. He's like, what's going on? I haven't felt pain in 10 years. I haven't felt pain in my legs for 10 years. What's happening here? And they do some more tests and check things out. And as it turns out, when he was in the motorcycle accident, his spinal cord wasn't severed. It was bruised. And Dr. Melendez says, it's very rare, it's unusual, but there are situations where a bruised spinal cord can begin to function again. And apparently that's happening with him. Well, along with that, they also discover that he has a non-malignant tumor that's kind of wrapped itself around his spinal column. And that tumor is compressing the spinal cord. And so the tumor's preventing the spinal cord that apparently has some capacity to work from actually sending messages down into his legs, except for in situations where there's intense pain. And so it's, you know, this very bizarre situation, But Dr. Melendez comes back and he says that if we remove this tumor, we think that you may be able to walk again. No guarantees, but that's what he seems to think. There's a reasonable chance he could walk. But there's also another complication in that the tumor has made its way up. It's encroached into the base of his skull and into his brainstem, and that if they remove the tumor, there's a chance he could die. And so Hunter's got all this stuff running around in his head. You know, he wants to walk badly. Obviously, he doesn't want to risk his life. What does he do? He says, well, give me a number on this. What's the odds? And Linda says, well, you know, I don't like to try to give percentages, but there's a number. Just tell me what you think it is. And he says, I think there's about a 15% chance you could die if we remove this tumor. And so Hunter has to think over what he wants to do. And of course, well, I shouldn't say of course, but he decides that he wants to have the surgery. And then his wife, who's so loving and supportive and understanding, she gets angry about this. And of course, she fears that he could die, that he would die. And she asks him, well, you don't care what I think? And Hunter says, well, you know, we have a great life together, but I'm the one that's paralyzed. I'm the one that's stuck in this chair. And she almost shouts at him. And she says, we're in this together. You know, who helps you get up the stairs? Who pushes you through the sand so you put your feet in the water? You know, you want to gamble your life that you have for the life that you had? And then she says, I'm not going to stand by and watch you die. If you want to selfishly gamble your life away, you're doing it on your own. And, of course, he's stunned by this. And he says, well, I'm doing this for us. And she says, no, you're doing this for you. And then she walks out the room. And Hunter's shocked by this, of course, and he's got the startled look on his face, and he doesn't say this with much conviction, but he kind of glances up at Dr. Melendez, and he says, she'll be back. Now, Hunter's wife, of course, she fears that her husband might die, and she also fears that if he can walk, that he won't need her anymore, and either way, she's afraid she's going to lose her husband. And at the same time, this fear has creeped into Hunter's mind that if he goes to this operation, that Cora might actually abandon him. She just walked out. She said, you're doing this on your own. And so here we got a situation with these two different relationships between Emma and Barry and Cora and Hunter, and they all fear being rejected by their spouse. And it struck me that in a similar way, we oftentimes fear, and we have a measure of fear that we might be rejected by God. You know, Emma feared that if she wasn't beautiful enough, she couldn't be loved by her husband. Don't we fear that? We're not attractive enough. We're not beautiful enough. God might not love us. You know, Barry feared that if his shame, the source of his shame, was found out, he might not be accepted. We try to hide our shame from God, or just convinced that he won't accept us if he really knew who we are, like we can hide from God. Cora needed to be wanted. She was sure that if she wasn't needed by her husband, she would no longer be wanted by him. And we feel like, what can I do that God would need me? And as a result, we're afraid that, why would he want me? And then, of course, Hunter was afraid that if he didn't do what his wife wanted, that she would abandon him. And how often do we feel like, if I don't do everything God expects of me, if God demands me, that he might abandon me, he might just walk away? The devil gets in our head and convinces us that we're unwanted, we're shameful, we're unneeded, we're not worth having, and our hearts are filled with fear that God might reject us. And to be rejected is one of the most painful human experiences we can have, isn't it? I think back when you're little kids, I think every child has probably experienced this one time or another, at school or even among friends at home, and there's a group of friends that decide they're going to be spiteful and they exclude the other one. They won't let that other person in the circle. And it hurts so bad to be rejected, to be left out. And even as adults, you know, if we really want to hurt somebody or we really feel hurt when we're given the silent treatment, right? And one of the worst things that people can say, one of the cruelest things people can say is something like, that person is dead to me. Or as far as I'm concerned, they don't even exist. To be rejected is painful. And without question, the worst punishment possible is to be rejected by God. To be rejected by God is to be separated from the one with whom we've been created to be in a relationship. It is to be separated from everything that's good, and it's to be left subject to everything that's evil. And so to be rejected by God is That's what it is to suffer the punishment of hell. And we get a glimpse of that on earth when we feel rejected by God, and it can become a reality in eternity. And the good news is the great physician has the perfect antidote for our fear of rejection, and actually the antidote for rejection itself. And this episode of The Good Doctor shows us how that antidote takes effect. If you look at 1 John in chapter 4, verse 18, we're told there's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment. There's another doctor named Dr. Resnick, and she comes to the cafeteria. She finds Barry, who's just kind of in a state of, he's just stunned right now. He doesn't know what to do. He's kind of in a comatose state walking around. And she's very, very bold. She's very, she doesn't pull back any punches. And she goes right up to him, and she says, in my experience, there's only two reasons for a person to have that much cosmetic surgery. Either she's halfway out the door, or you are. And then Dr. Resnick says to him, your wife is going to die unless you convince her that she doesn't need any of this cosmetic surgery because you are a faithful and loving husband. And Barry's kind of jolted out of his daze, I guess, that he's in, and he kind of feebly goes back to his wife's room, and he says, honey, you have to have the surgery. And she has her back to the door. You know, she's just depressed. She's in a state of denial, and she turns over and she looks at him and she says, you were distant before, but since the surgery, you can't get enough of me. It worked. You're happy. I'm happy. And then he blurts out, I love you. I've always loved you. And she says, if you loved me, you never would have cheated on me. Barry, please, no more lies. You were never at home. We never talked. You were never there. And then Barry says, there was never another woman. But he confesses, I was gambling a lot. He said, I did it because I was ashamed of the man that I had become. And when I married you, I promised you the world, and I gave you a mediocre life. And so all this cosmic surgery that Emma has had was driven by fear, but it's also become clear that the husband, that Barry, is filled with fear too. He felt inadequate to be loved by his wife because he saw himself as a failure. And he tried to compensate for the sense of inadequacy by gambling. And when he won, he felt great. When he lost, his shame snowballed. And he feared that if his secret was found out, she'd completely lose respect for him. He was ashamed of his addiction, so he avoided his wife. But now they begin to understand each other's fears. And they begin to trust that they're loved by the other, that their love is rekindled. Emma believes that Barry will love her even if she isn't so physically attractive. And Barry believes that Emma will love him in spite of his shameful behavior. Their love casts out their fear of being rejected. And Emma agrees to have her implants removed. And Barry has his burden lifted of feeling like a failure. Now, with Hunter and Cora, they also experience the power that love has to cast out fear. Now, Cora fears that if Hunter can walk, that he won't need her anymore, and he's afraid of being rejected by him. And this fear is so strong that she actually prefers that he not try to walk. And Hunter fears that if he goes through the surgery, that Cora might leave him. And so she fears being unneeded, he fears being abandoned, and again we see this irony. It's the fear that they'll be rejected by the other that's driving them apart. Well, eventually, Cora comes back to the room, and as soon as she walks in the door, Hunter says, I can't do this without you. She says, I can't do anything without you. And then Cora is able to admit her feelings, and she says, you know, if you could walk, you'll be different, and you might not need me anymore. And then this is the great line. He says, do you think I married you because I need help hanging up my clothes in the closet? He said, you're my girl. He says, I will always need you. Who's going to remind me to call my mother on her birthday? Who's going to help me to become a better person? Who's going to hold my hand when I'm scared? And she reaches out and she holds his hand and they gaze into each other's eyes and the tears start to well up. And the whole time they're having this touching moment, Dr. Murphy is standing over in the corner and he turns around and he says, that was nice. It's just great. When we trust that our spouse, or anyone else for that matter, truly loves us, the fear that we'll be rejected is cast out. And that same principle applies to our relationship with God. And so John says in verse 17, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment. When we believe that God loves us, our fear is cast out. We're no longer afraid that we'll suffer punishment by being rejected by God and being separated from Him on the judgment day. And that carries over to our daily life. We believe that God's going to accept us, that He has accepted us, that we're freed by His love. It enables us then to love God in return. And so, and we can love others as well. By God's grace, He's chosen to love us in spite of our sin. And when we put our faith in Jesus, it casts out that fear. We can approach the throne of grace with boldness, we're told in Hebrews chapter 4. And so then John says, as He is, so are we. So as Jesus loves us in spite of our brokenness, our sin, our shame, all the things that we want to hide from God, as Jesus loves us in spite of those things, now we are able to love God and we're able to love others as Jesus does. And in another scene, Dr. Murphy asked Dr. Brown if she would marry someone who has a disability. And she says, yeah, I could do that. And Dr. Murphy says, you could have the ideal mate, Claire. Why would you want to deal with the unnecessary burden? And she says this great line. She says, everybody is dealing with something. We just have to love people for who they are and hope that they'll love us too. That's exactly what God does for us. That's why John says in verse 19, we love because He first loved us. God knows we're all dealing with something. We all have sin in our life that makes us feel like Emma, that we're not beautiful, and so why would we be lovable? Or we're like Barry, that we have this shame within us, and we're trying to hide from God, and how could He possibly accept us? Or we're like Cora, we think, what could I possibly do that God needs from me, so why would He want me? Or we're like Hunter, and we think, if I don't do everything that God wants of me, if God expects of me, that He's going to just abandon me. He'll just walk out the door. We wonder why God would want to deal with the unnecessary burden of someone like me. We can't fathom why God would want someone like me to be with Him in heaven. And yet He loves us. And God hopes that we'll love Him too. And you know, love doesn't insist on its own way. God can't force us to love Him. But if we truly realize the depth of God's love, the effect of His grace, that He loves and accepts and forgives us in spite of ourselves, if we truly grasp that, it's inevitable that we're going to love Him in return. And God doesn't just free us to love Him, He also frees us to love other people. He says in verse 21, the commandment we have from Him is this, those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. And we've all experienced how hard this is, right? We've all experienced the situations where we just feel like, I can't love this person. My sin gets in the way. Their sin gets in the way. They do something I hate. I do something they hate. I have strong feelings about a certain topic that they have complete opposite beliefs in. And we just rub each other. There's just friction every time we try to talk to one another. It was like, we can't do this. Like the couples in the show, we don't trust that they'll truly accept us. We feel unlovable, ashamed, unneeded, afraid of being abandoned. And yet God commands us to love. And the love requires us to take this risk. It hurts to be rejected. It hurts when people don't want to be in relationship with us. And it hurts because these relationships matter. They're important to us. And in spite of the pain, we need to love them anyway. And of course, we hope that they'll love us in return. But the thing is, our love for them does not depend upon their love for us. We tend to think that, oh, it won't do any good. They're not going to respond anyway, so what's the point in trying? Me loving this person does not depend upon them loving me. My love for that person is a response to and empowered by God's love for me. And I know that God loves me. And it's not just a matter of remembering that God loves me. I need to be immersed in the love of God. John 16, 4, chapter, 1 John 4, 16 says, God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. It's like we need to be so immersed in God's love. God's love needs to fill our hearts so completely that it drives out the fear. God's love needs to fill our hearts so completely. We need to abide in His love so deeply that drives out that critical spirit that we have that will lead the other person to think that we won't love them. And when that begins to take place, then by God's grace, we can love the other as God loves us. Now, Emma finally gives her consent to have these implants removed, but this whole time, Dr. Andrews has been warning her how dangerous this is. We need to do this now. Well, finally, they rush her into the operating room. They have the operation, but the infection has spread too far, and it was too late. And so Barry is brought into this room to see his wife, and the sheet is pulled over her head, and the medical assistant, or whomever it is, pulls the sheet back so he can look at his wife's face. And he falls to his knees next to the gurney, and he's weeping, and he starts to stroke his wife's hair. And with each stroke, you see his wedding band just kind of jump out of the TV screen. In the meantime, Hunter is being wheeled in on a gurney to have his tumor removed, and Cora's walking alongside him with the medical team, and they get at a certain point down the hall, and someone says to Cora, this is as far as you can go. You're not going to stop here. And so they stop, and Cora gives Hunter a kiss, and then Hunter's got this kind of alarmed look on his face, and you can almost read what's going on in his mind. It's like, if I do this, I could die, and I'm going to leave my wife behind, and she's going to suffer because I was selfish. And he says, I can't do this. But Cora takes a deep breath, and she says, yes, you can. This is what we do in a relationship, right? We take chances together. And so he has a surgery, and everything goes great, and Dr. Melendez comes into his room and shares the good news, how well it went, and Dr. Melendez is excitingly sharing how, you know, he's going to have to do this and that for the rehab, and it's possible that he'll be able to walk. And Hunter's ecstatic. He says, thank you, and he's got this big smile on his face. But then he says, do you mind if we talk about this later? Right now, I just want to be with my wife. And Hunter and Cora kiss, and they hold each other, and this is a beautiful scene of two people who trust that one loves the other. Now, the show ends with Dr. Andrews going home, and there's a little side story where he and his wife have been having some problems. And Dr. Andrews is on the couch. It's kind of dark. The fireplace is gently lit in the back, and he's got this glass of wine, and you can see he's in deep thought. And his wife comes up kind of behind him and sits on the back of the couch kind of behind him. And he says, I met a couple today who lost their way. And they loved each other, but by the time they remembered what really matters, it was too late. He said, I don't want to be like them. He says, I want to be fully committed to you. And she has kind of this coy smile on her face, and she says, I love you too. Maybe you have an underlying fear that God will reject you. Maybe you think, I'm not beautiful enough for him to love me. Maybe you have this shame in the back of your mind of something that you've done, and you think, he's not going to accept me. Maybe you feel like that you have to be needed by God, and you can't possibly do anything that requires God to need you, and so he's not going to want you. Maybe you know you haven't done everything that God wants you to do, everything that God expects of you, and so you're afraid that he's going to abandon you and just walk out the door. Well, the episode, The Good Doctor, shows us how love can cast out fear. And the great physician has the antidote for that fear. He's demonstrated his love for us when Jesus died on the cross to pay the penalty for our sins. He makes us beautiful. He makes us holy. He takes away our shame. He says, yes, you are wanted, and I will never abandon you. He gave everything for us when he gave his life on the cross. God loves you, and he hopes only that you will love him in return. So be sure to remember what really matters: loving God with all your heart, loving your neighbor as yourself. Remember what matters before it's too late. Amen. Our offering text today is from 1 John as well, chapter 3, verse 16 through 18. 1 John says, we know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees their brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? And so as we give to the church and as we give towards God's kingdom, we give towards worshiping the Lord, but also to helping those who are in need. So let us give generously for God's glory. Please stand and let's confess what we believe using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. He shall come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we go out from this place, may we trust and believe that God's love drives out our every fear. And as he is one who loves us out of his mercy and grace, let us also be able to love him with all of our heart and to love our neighbor as ourself. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Who has numbered every grain of sand? Cornerstone.